Looks like there were several that stayed home to watch the Super Bowl. Well, all right. Praise the Lord. We have people watching from around the state of West Virginia, Arizona, Delaware, Florida, Georgia, Illinois, Maryland, Missouri, North Carolina, Ohio, Oregon, Pennsylvania, South Carolina, Tennessee, Texas, and Virginia. Could you make welcome our internet congregation? Praise the Lord. Well, if it's all right with you, I would like to share with you the word that I had last Sunday night, and I was getting ready to share it, but the Lord just didn't move in that fashion, so I'd like to share it with you tonight if I could. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Numbers chapter 11. Numbers chapter 11. I want to thank Pastor Jay for immediately filling in for me this morning at 10:45. I was called away. And he filled in, and two were saved in here, and two were saved over in Kids Church. And can you just say amen to that? And thank God for it. Praise the Lord. If you're at Numbers 11, say amen.
Amen.
All right. I want to have a little bit of fun, first of all, and then I'll get to the meat of the message. The main focus I want to focus on is verses 11 through 17. But I want to set it up first and try to, and the word that I have seems to be brief. But I want to try to, I know, I would laugh too if I were you. It seems to be brief, Melanie, it seems to be brief. But I want to try to set this up and give us an indication of exactly where Moses was at. In Numbers 11, verses 1 and 2, it says, "Now when the people complained, it displeased the Lord, for the Lord heard it." So in other words, if you're going to complain, don't let God hear it. Good luck with that one. And it said that it displeased the Lord, for the Lord heard it, and his anger was aroused. So the fire of the Lord burned among them and consumed some on the outskirts of the camp. Right there would have been lesson enough for me just seeing a brother or sister consumed by fire to keep my mouth shut. Or at least not to be on the outer skirts. I'm at least going to be in as close to Moses as I can get. Because the fire falls there, it's holy fire, amen, not angered fire. But they complained to the point to where it angered God. He sent fire down, and it consumed some on the outer skirts of the children of Israel. And then if you look at verse 2, it says the people came to Moses, cried out, said, "God," or, "Moses, would you do something?" And it said that Moses prayed to God and the fire stopped. This is God's man. You can read in the Old Testament that he was not a mere prophet that God spoke to in dreams and visions. But God said to Miriam and to her brother, said, "This is the man that I know face to face." Yes, I wish to God I had a relationship with God that I could just pray and he answered just like that. But then we find out in the next few verses that they didn't learn their lesson. They continued to complain. In verses 4 through 6, "Now the mixed multitude who were among them yielded to intense craving. So the children of Israel also wept again and said, 'Who will give us meat to eat?'" This is what they were complaining about. They had fresh manna that fell from heaven daily. And they wanted meat instead of manna. They complained. They had God's supply and provision, and they complained about God's supply and provision. They wanted what they wanted. "We remember the fish which we ate freely in Egypt." That's a joke right there. Because we know there wasn't anything freely going on in Egypt, because Egypt itself means bondage. Isn't it amazing how you can look back and say things can seem so much better looking back? Yeah. "We remember the fish that we ate freely in Egypt, the cucumbers." I can't stand cucumbers. Yeah. "The melons, the leeks, the onions, and the garlic." Oh, that sounds wonderful. "But now our whole being is dried up. There is nothing at all except this manna before our eyes." They continued to complain. And Moses was their leader.
God charged Moses to lead Israel out of Egypt into the promised land. Moses was hiding on the backside of the desert. And I want to talk to you about an experience that Moses had with God. And it wasn't the burning bush experience. It wasn't just the manna falling from heaven, and it wasn't the Red Sea splitting experience. But it was a time when Moses felt like that he had done all that he could and his best wasn't good enough, and he just wanted to die. He was listening to all this complaining of all the Israelites about how they didn't have meat to eat. Verses 11 through 15, so Moses said to the Lord, "Why have you afflicted me, your servant? And why have I not found favor in your sight? And you have laid this burden of all these people on me." Moses was leading the greatest church on the face of the earth at the time. He went from being by himself and his wife and children to a church of roughly over 2 to 3 million people. I don't know of a pastor in the United States of America that wouldn't love to pastor 2 or 3 million people until they truly begin to carry the burden. Numbers look great. Anybody can preach. But there's few pastors willing to carry a burden for God's people. My God. I didn't feel this when I was preparing this. He said, "Did I conceive all these people? Did I beget them? That you should say to me, carry them on your bosom as a guardian carries a nursing child to the land which you have sworn to give their fathers? Where am I to get meat to feed all these people? For they weep all over me saying, give me meat that they may eat. I'm not able to bear all these people alone because the burden is too heavy for me," Moses said. Oh, I love verse 15. "If you treat me like this," Moses said, "please kill me here and now." I love that. Feel free to laugh right there. Sometimes you got to laugh, keep from crying. "If I found favor in your sight, and do not let me see my wretchedness. If this is the way you're going to treat me, God, kill me here and now. Just get it over with. And what we have here is a prayer of a burned out pastor. He was carrying it all. He was doing it all. And that was not God's ordained plan. No one can carry it all alone, regardless of how good they are. No one could have stood in Moses' shoes and carried that all by himself. And no one can stand in this pulpit or any other pulpit in America and carry it all by themselves. God never intended for any one person to carry anything all by themselves. I don't care how good, I don't care how anointed, I don't care how gifted, I don't care how educated, I don't care how equipped anyone is. God has never called anyone to carry it all by themselves. I'll preach it to myself. Some of the most underrated people in the kingdom of God are kids' church pastors, youth pastors, congregational care pastors, lay pastors, associate pastors, and bless God, we have all of them. How would you like it if you had 15-second notice that you were going to get up here and fill my shoes on Sunday morning? Yet that's what he did. He didn't bat an eye and she didn't bat an eye. They just went right ahead because they leaned not to their own understanding, but in all their ways. Jay said, "Pastor, is your notes up there?" I said, "Yeah, man, help yourself." I write my notes out in tongues. You got to have the gift of interpreting. That's a joke. That's a joke. That's a joke. If there's anybody visitors, that's just a joke. Until you have to read it and then decipher it for yourself. I called him to see how things went. He said, Pastor, he said, it was God. I said, yes. Do you know what that's like? Do you know what it is to be a pastor of a 1,500-member church and be called out and in the middle of service with no advance notice and a man or woman of God get in the pulpit and it flows just like nothing was ever missed and two souls get saved? Oh, I don't know about you, but it blesses me. It lets me know that God is greater than just one man or one woman. It doesn't buffet me. It doesn't bother me whatsoever. I thank God that he's bigger than one man or one woman. Shoo! That stirs in my heart. Let me tell you something. This is going to blow some of your mind. If there's any senior pastors watching, you may not want to show this to your congregation. But let me tell you something. Kids church pastor, a youth pastor, an associate pastor, a lay pastor, lay ministry coordinating pastor, and forgive me if I'm forgetting any others, their calling is just as high as any senior pastor. And I'm good with that. Because the key is when everyone is in their place, when everyone is in their called position, not jockeying for position. But when everyone is in their called position, the kingdom of God, the gates of hell will not prevail against her. Praise God. This is turning out better than he showed me too. The trap is this. The devil recognizes that he cannot get in front of us and block our way. So instead, he gets behind us and pushes us, selling us the lie that we have to do everything, we have to do it personally, and we have to do it immediately. You think about that. You think about all the things that you have to do and how you just strive and how you work hard. And if I want to do something right, I got to do it myself. How many's ever said that? That's a lie from the pits of hell. What it really is that didn't meet my expectations, so I'm going to go ahead and redo it myself because you're not good enough. No, they just don't do it like you do it. It's still finished. It may just not be the way that you wanted to do it. You won't shovel the sidewalk like I will. You won't mow grass like I will. But we can both do it and it'll both get done and it'll both look good. Let me move on. The enemy keeps us so busy doing good things that we neglect the vital things. What are the vital things? Time with God and time in his word. I believe that this is the battle for every pastor in the nation right here. If we are truly called of God, I don't care if you're an associate pastor, what kind of pastor you are, I believe that this is a battle for every pastor. Time with God and studying in his word. Amen. Wednesdays are some of the most busiest days in the office. Why? Because it's Wednesday. You got to preach on Wednesday night. You can schedule your day and where your calendar is free, but there's something that comes up. Are you all getting quiet? That's okay. But there's a solution to it. It's given in verses 16 and 17. Now, let me read verse 15 again just because it's fun. If you're going to treat me like this, please kill me here and now. Has anybody ever said that? Nicole, you ever been there? Have you? Jay? You had about
11 o'clock this morning. I've been there. Hey, God, if this is it, just take me out. I'm ready to go home. Whoop. If this is the way you're going to treat me, God, just kill me here and now. If I found favor in your sight, and do not let me see my wretchedness. Verse 16. So the Lord said to Moses, gather to me. Notice God says, gather these people to me. Don't gather them to yourself. Gather them to me. 70 men of elders of Israel, whom you know to be elders of the people and officers over them. Bring them to the tabernacle of meeting that they may stand there with you. Then I will come down. Oh, I like that. Then I will come down and talk with you there. I will take the spirit that is upon you, and I will put the same upon them, and they shall bear the burden of the people with you, that you may not bear it yourself alone. This is God's response to a burned out pastor's prayer. The solution is found in 16:17. It's they begin to worship together. They get in the presence of God together. And when we worship together, when we get in the presence of God together, things begin to change. Things begin to shake. Things begin to move. Peace begins to settle down. Oh, this is helping me. My job is to feed you well. I know you've heard that for the past 2 weeks. Pastor Joey, I've read the book you gave me. I'm in the process of reading the book. I love it, by the way. But my job is to feed you well. If I feed you well, if I give you good nourishment from God's word, I'm imparting to you. I'm imparting to you what God has placed upon me. He's placed something upon me. It doesn't make me special. It makes me responsible. My responsibility to you as a congregation is to teach you what God has taught me, to lay my hand on you, to speak over you, to say, speak blessing over you. Why? So you can take what you learn in here, so you can take what you impart in here out into a dark, dry, and dismal world and infiltrate it with darkness. That's what we're called to do. Something happens when we get into an atmosphere like this. Impartation begins to take place.
Yes.
Something happens when we're together and we begin to worship, and it is not supposed to stop at the end of service. It's to continue on. Take it to Mayberry's, or take it to DeWhite's, or Taco Bell, or Walmart, or wherever it is you go after service.
Yes, sir.
Something happens when we get in an atmosphere together and we focus our attention to God. Listen, we all have problems. We all have issues we're dealing with. We all have stuff. And sometimes you come in here weighted down and heavy. I know. Listen, I've been there. Sometimes I'm there now. I get it. But when we get into a Holy Ghost-filled service, there is a lift. When you have a worship leader that doesn't just sing a song, but has spent time in the presence of Almighty God, that they know Daddy's heart, that they're able to sing. And when they begin to sing, something begins to stir. The seraphim begin to... The seraphim begin to be stirred. They begin to cry, holy, holy, holy. And the atmosphere begins to turn and the burden begins to lift. What is that? It's called divine, intense, prophetic worship. And it begins to transform the atmosphere. And that's why and how you can come in so burdened down. And you get into the middle of service and you never want it to stop, because the first time in 24 hours, you have felt a little bit of peace. You felt a little bit of joy. You felt a little bit of help. You felt a little bit of energy. But yet at the same time, when we spend time in His presence and when we get in God's Word, it does the exact same thing. It's amazing that when we get into a service,
Did you notice in that, in I think it was that last song, that the Holy Spirit was moving and stirring, and Nicole kept driving that verse, chorus. I'm not a musically inclined, obviously, you know that, but she just began to drive that chorus over and over, and as she began to drive, why? Because God was breathing on that. When God begins to breathe, the religious begin to leave. That just hit me. Because the religious can't stand to sing anything over and over again. And they'll get on that and they'll complain about that. But what you have to understand, that's God breathing. He's breathing on that. And I don't care how old something might be, that it can be sang. And he begins to breathe on that and breathe on that. And it begins to stir. It begins to create. It begins to give life. And people begin to get encouraged. They begin to draw strength from that. Salvation begins to stir. Life begins to be given. And peace begins to descend down. How is it that, like Moses, God, if I found favor in your sight, just kill me here and now. I don't think I can take it anymore, God. God, you've shown me great things. You've called me to great heights. You've given me dreams and visions. You've begun to reveal yourself to me. But God, if this is the weightiness of it, I can't do it. Just kill me here and now. How do we get through those moments of life? It's a simple word. It's called trust. I read it to you this morning in Proverbs chapter 3, verses 4 through 6, or 5 and 6. It says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not to your own understanding. And in all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path. Trust, that word trust means to attach oneself to. I see the picture of a sucking calf to its mother nursing. Attach yourself to the Lord Jesus Christ as though your life depends on it, because it does. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, or with all your heart, and lean not to your own understanding. Trust Him when you don't understand. Then in Psalm 56 verse 3, I love this. David, you know, everybody sees David high and lifted up, sees King David, Almighty David, and yes, he was. But that man walked through so many valleys. I believe that's why he was exalted the way that he was because of the degree of valleys that he walked through. But David, in Psalm 56, verse 3, he was in one of those valleys, and this is what David said: what time I'm afraid, I will trust in you, God. When I don't understand, God, I'm going to trust in you. When I feel fear begin to grip me, God, I'm not going to lean under that, God, but I'm going to trust in you. When I see things I don't understand, when things begin to shake around me, I'm going to trust in you, God. When I begin to walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil because I trust that you are with me, oh God. What time I am afraid, I will trust in you. But then I found this today in Jeremiah. In Jeremiah, I love the prophets. In Jeremiah chapter 17, verses 7 and 8. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord and whose hope is the Lord. It's just trust and hope. Trust and hope. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord and whose hope is in the Lord, for he shall be like a tree planted by the waters, which spreads out its roots by the river and will not fear when heat comes. Oh, I like that. But its leaf will be green and will not be anxious in the year of drought, nor will it cease from yielding fruit. Trust and hope. We possess those two qualities of God, trust and hope. will be like a tree planted by the river. Joni Ames was in some time back. She was telling me about the redwood tree. And if you've heard this before, please forgive me. I hadn't heard it. Some of you are probably scholars and have already read this. And you know, these big redwood trees, they grow to like 300, 320 feet tall. And how deep do you think those roots go on that redwood tree? I mean, they grow so big around that you can literally drive a car through them. They have some redwood trees that have been carved out and cut out that you can actually drive through them. And how deep are the roots? Do you remember? You don't remember? Anybody remember how deep the roots are? I'm thinking about 3 feet. Am I right? Get a hold of that now. The redwood tree that is 300 feet tall, its roots are 3 feet deep. Yet when the wind blows, they don't topple over. How can they do that? Because instead of their roots growing down, they grow out. And redwood trees has this instinctive identity that when they grow out, they recognize another redwood tree's roots and they latch a hold of it. They curl themselves around one another so that when the wind begins to blow this way, this one over here is holding this one up. It said that a redwood tree could be dead, I think, up to 100 years and never fall because of the relationship, my God, because of the relationship in its roots with the other redwood trees. There's power when the storm comes and the wind blows and there is a church that's willing to have some roots, willing to have some relationship, that they'll lock themselves arm to arm, shoulder to shoulder. And when my brother begins to wane, that's okay, man. I've got you. I'll stand strong for you. And tomorrow you can do it for me. This is what happens when we trust in the Lord. Stand to your feet and give God praise. And I'm through. Tonight, I want you to gather around the altar and just pray. Just come and spend a few moments in His presence. Come and pray. Come and cry out to God. Come on, I'm asking you to do just what I preached to you. Come and just spend some time in His presence. And just pray to Him. Say, God, I need help tonight. I need You to show up in my life tonight, God. I need You to show up in circumstances that's blowing around me, God. If you're here tonight and you don't know Him as your Savior, I want you to come. I want you to come. I want you to find someone around here and say, would you just pray the prayer of salvation with me? And if you can't lead him to the Lord, get him to somebody who can. I want the staff to come and pray. And be sensitive. Be sensitive. Be sensitive to the voice of the Holy Spirit. Burden bearers. Prayer warriors. Intercessor. Come and pray. Be sensitive. If you have a need in your life, you come. Right where you are, if you can't get around the altar, could you just lift your hand as JD and Nicole begin to sing? Could you just lift your arms and just begin to worship God right where you are?
Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray that our trust and our hope, God, would be in you. And what time I am afraid, God, I'll trust in you. Oh, Father, we thank you for the blessed hope, God. We thank you for trust, Father. And Lord, I pray that we'd be redwood trees to each other, God. We learn how our roots to be locked together and hold each other up when the storms rage, the wind blows. And Lord, even when it seems like we get a little bit of dry, maybe it seems like death's trying to creep in, God. May we have another 100 years, God, of standing strong for you. So, Father, I pray that you would just impart life, trust, and hope to every member in this house right now, God. I pray that you give them the very life that breathes trust and hope. And Father, I pray that you would just lead us, you would guide us, direct us. Direct our path, I pray. Lead us in the way everlasting. And I thank you for it. And I ask it in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. May the Lord bless you. We'll see you Wednesday night. Thank you for coming tonight.